they all got to.
I'm Yasuo Ogata from Japan. So far, so excellent. In this conference, I have been inspired by all the remarks. I participated for the first time in the Global Network Conference in India last November. Since then, I have been more and more adhering to the Global Network. This is my honest feelings, and I'm full of thanks. So may I sit and speak, okay? Thank you.
Okay.
I'd like to focus my presentation on the increasingly dangerous situation in North Asia. North Korea conducted two nuclear tests and launched more than 20 missiles last year. On March 6 this year, it fired four ballistic missiles that launched the Sea of Japan after reaching an altitude about 260 kilometers. Regarding this missile launch, North Korea made an unprecedented announcement stating that, quote, the exercise was held by military unit tasked to attack US base in Japan, unquote. Following this announcement, Japan, the United States, and South Korea conducted joint ballistic missile defense exercise for 2 days from March 14 in the water near Japan and South Korea. And very recently, on 6 April, North Korea fired a newly developed ballistic missile just before the first US-China summit. Regarding relations with North Korea, the Trump administration criticized the predecessor's policy of strategic tensions as a failed policy and began arguing on confrontational approach toward North Korea, which places all options are on the table, implicitly a military option. It was reported that the February meeting between President Trump and Prime Minister Abe confirmed that all options include a US military attack on North Korea in response to a move to conduct a ballistic missile launch test. The United States was at the brink of carrying out the preemptive military attack against North Korea in 1994. This military crisis was averted through direct communications between Washington and Pyongyang, in addition to strong opposition from China, resistance to military option by South Korea, and Japan's hesitation to support the use of military option. At present, it is clearly understood by all parties that a military strike would cause catastrophic damage with devastating consequences, make it difficult for the US to implement the military option. Given the current deadlock over the measures to stop North Korea's test, it is difficult to ignore the possibility of the preemptive attack against the North. US attack against Syria yesterday midnight could be understood as a sign or a warning. If such action is taken, North Korea might attempt to launch its ballistic missile in retaliation. The current situation of escalating tension is prompting both South Korea and Japan to improve their defense system to intercept missiles launched from the north. A state of the art missile defense system placed in South Korea and Japan could become a new risk factor in the region. Using North Korea's nuclear and missile development program as a pretext, the Japanese government is rapidly going ahead with the introduction of the state-of-the-art BMD system. The focus of this move is to develop a ballistic missile intercept system jointly with the US and strengthen Japan's readiness to respond. The Japanese Defense Ministry has decided on measures to achieve this. They plan to complete the Japan-US joint development SM-3 Block 2A interceptors designed for Aegis warship by the end of fiscal 2017 and began to deploy them to vessels of maritime self-defense forces in fiscal 2020. The ministry also has a plan to procure PAC-3 MSE interceptors and deploy them to the air defense forces in 2019, a year ahead of schedule. They originally planned to put 30 missiles in place after the current 5-year defense build-up program come to an end in 2018, but the government appropriated $280 million for research and development costs in the third supplementary budget for the fiscal 2016. In February, the ruling Liberal Democrat Party set up a task force to discuss how to enhance the BMD system and capability to attack enemy bases. We have to face the fact that under the Abe-Trump alliance recently formed, the two governments are accelerating cooperation in this field. In addition, the Japanese government's move to strengthen the BMD system also matches the Trump administration's Buy American policy, as Aegis Ashore and third are product of Lockheed Martin. Taking advantage of Japan's relaxed rule on arms export, Prime Minister Abe expanding Japan-US technical and economic cooperation to the military field in order to support President Trump politically and economically. Since Prime Minister Abe took power in 2012, the government has been promoting Japan-US military cooperation in the field of space technologies. In 2014, an expanded radar base was constructed and started operation at Kyogamisaki in Northern Tokyo. This is the second expanded radar base in Japan after the one placed in Aomori Tsukaru City. The 2015 guideline for Japan-US defense cooperation include space-related plans for the first time ever. The Japanese Self-Defense Forces and US forces set up a joint working group on cooperation in this regard. The Abe government in 2015 decided on its third basic plan for space policies. The top priority of this plan's three targets is to secure Japan's use of space for security purposes. This is aimed at improving military and intelligence gathering capabilities. Japan is becoming more and more involved in the US-led missile defense initiatives. The draft resolution on the peaceful utilization of space of 1969, based on the Pacifist Constitution, restricted space development and utilization only to peaceful purpose and prohibit its utilization for the military. Nevertheless, the fundamental law concerning space of 2008 positioned the space development and utilization as an activity contributing to the security of the country, thus paving the way for its utilization for the military. The Japanese Constitution prohibits the exercise of the right of collective self-defense, and all the past LDP governments have continued to adhere to this position. However, in 2015, the Abe cabinet railroaded the national security legislation through the National Diet, enabling Japan to exercise the right to collective self-defense in order to participate in war waged by the United States anywhere in the world. The US Armed Forces are geared to conduct military operations in Northeast Asia with the support of Japanese military capabilities. The national security legislation was essential to enable the government of Japan not only to fight war together with the United States on the Earth, but also in space. Missile development is to missile defense what a pipe is to steel. Both missile development and missile defense will bring about an arms race and only lead to raising tensions among nations, resulting in the creation of the military predominance and preemptive attacks arrangement. They will not defend people's security at all, but will require a huge amount of taxpayers' money. They will worsen relations with neighboring countries and will become a source of tension in the end. As we are witnessing strong opposition from China and Russia to the US deployment of the threat in South Korea, advancement of missile defense will bring about a heightened tension in the region. In this regard, the Abe administration contains dangerous elements of Japan's past militarism because, far from expressing remorse over Japan's past war aggression, it embraces the ideology to eulogizing the war as a war of justice. The only way to address and resolve the issue threatening peace in Northeast Asia through dialogue. There is no platform for talks amongst states concerned in Northeast Asia. In the past, six-party talks worked, and 2005, all parties agreed an epoch-making roadmap for normalizing relationship between United States and North Korea, between Japan and North Korea, and creating peace in Northeast Asia. However difficult it may be, we have to return to this map to try to solve the problem through diplomacy. After the crisis that erupted on the Korean Peninsula in 1994, William Perry recommended in his report that they should address the crisis with an understanding that premised that current regime of North Korea would last for the time being. And thus, they should avoid giving priority to military options, and they should approach the issues at hand in a comprehensive and integrated manner through peaceful means and negotiations. These recommendations are valid to this day. In conclusion, I'd like to mention the ongoing struggle against the construction of bases for U.S. missile defense in Japan. Residents in Kyoto and Aomori are opposing the installation of expand radar sites. It is important to inform citizens that missile defense can defend neither the land nor citizens who lead to ruin and cause a fortune. Since the government is using scare tactics on Japanese citizens by greatly exaggerating the threat of attack by North Korea, we are engaged in activities inform as many citizens as possible about the inherent danger of arms race in space. Struggle today requires that they should be globally integrated, informing each other of our activities and strengthening our solidarity in trans-border alliances. We carry on the struggles opposing militarization and the war. Thank you very much for attention.
Thank you very much. And we have about a half an hour for questions and answers, comments. Why don't we do as we did in the previous session, take three at a time. And we do have a microphone, if we can have someone play that role, walk the microphone around with the speakers. Anybody? Thanks, Mike. And who has a question or a comment? Okay, Regis, hang on, get a microphone.
First of all, thank you very much for attending the conference and for sharing with us your experience of speaking truth to power in your countries. I went to South Korea in 2015 to make my first feature documentary, The Ghost of Jeju. And I went to Kangjeong Village, and I spent quite a bit of time there with the people who had been involved in a very long, peaceful, non-violent protest against the construction of that large military base that was built to accommodate America's pivot. What struck me about the protests there and the other protests that I've seen in Korea and the protests that have occurred in South Korea in the last year is an example for the peace movement all over the world, but especially in this country, of how it is done. You saw in the presentation massive groups of people in sustained resistance to the system. And if you notice, what I noticed is that people were energized by being together. They were creative, they were artistic, they sang, they danced, they made signs, they made flags, and they supported each other. Many religious groups came together to be part of this struggle. And Bruce Gagnon in The Ghost of Jeju said, what I opened with, this is an example for the peace movement all over the world of what we must do. And we must join together, not only in this country, but with people around the world, because you can see we're involved in the same struggle. Thank you for coming.
Deployment of missiles is because North Korea threatened South Korean, U.S. bases in South Korea, or did the North Koreans threaten to attack both the bases in South, U.S. bases in South Korea and Japan? That put a response on that.
Now, one more question.
Hi, thank you very much for coming from Korea and Songju. Do you predict that there will be as persistent a protest, and perhaps I was thinking of my question, I wasn't really listening before. Do you think there will be as a persistent and devoted protest resistance at Songju as there has been at Jeju? And how can Americans, how can Americans assist in helping you stop the system from going into
Songju? Okay, so it looks like maybe one question for Mr. Ogata and two for Reverend Kim. Mr. Ogata, would you like to respond to your question?
Yes, I mentioned that last launching test of missile by North Korea, at that time, North Korean authority expressed the unprecedented announcement. The announcement is that this exercise was taken place in order to attack, taking place by the unit, military unit, to attack attack U.S. bases in Japan. This is correct. Quotation, yes. That's all.
Reverend Jim, you had two questions to respond to. One about the protest that Reed is talking about, the quality of the protest in Jeju, and the other about the persistence of protest in Cheongju.
Yes. Thank you. 제주도라는 조그만 섬이기 때문에 좀 고립되어 있다는 느낌이 들어요, 한국에서도. 그래서 많은 사람이 연대하기가 좀 어려웠습니다.
So Jeju Island was a little bit isolated in the location wise. So it was really hard for the citizens to unite at the very beginning of the struggle.
그래서 특정인만이 거기서 이렇게 투쟁을 했지만 성주는 내륙에 있고 그리고 이렇게 모든 사람들이 지금 연대를 해서 처음에는 성주, 김천, 원불교가 했지만 조금 지나서는 전국에 있는 사람들이 매일 평화버스를 가지고 오고 투쟁을 하고 있기 때문에 충분히 사드를 물리치리라고 생각을 합니다.
So at the beginning, I mean, in Songju, the struggle for Gangjeong was a lot of people who were very progressive and really aware of the people only participated at the beginning to the end. But Songju, it's in the continent, first of all. And then also the villagers, not only the villagers of the Songju, Gimcheon, and Won Buddhism, but peace tour, peace buses are coming every day. So we think that they joined in at the very beginning of the struggle. And we believe that we will win eventually.
길게 가는 거에 대해서 말씀을 하셨는데 저희는 늘 모이면 매일 하루도 안 빠지고 지금 270일째 촛불을 들고 있는데 그것을 네 가지 원칙이 있습니다. 첫째는 즐겁게, 신나게, 즐기게, 건강하게 매일매일 그렇게 외치고면서 중간중간에 퍼포먼스 행사 를 하고 있습니다. 패션쇼도 하고 뭐 노래도 와서 해주고 가수들이 찾아오기도 하고 많은 사람들이 같이 연대를 해주기 때문에 지루하다는 생각보다는 그날그날 축제로 즐기고 있습니다.
So we talked about the persistence and that the length of the struggle and for the 270 days, it's a short days maybe, but every single day if you do it, it's a long day, long period. We call it four slogans. One, lively. Two, energetically. Three, persistently. And four, healthfully. So we always call it out that these four slogans every day. We are aware that we have to be very determined to continue this struggle until that we win. We include not only the rallies and speeches and our own educations, political speeches, but also songs and dances and fashion shows. So we don't think this is going to be only the political agenda, but we are trying to put it into our daily life system so that, you know, we can continue until we win. Thank you.
그래서 저희는 죽는 그날까지, 사드가 물러가는 그날까지 투쟁을 할 건데, 에, 지금 박근혜 정부가 내려왔기 때문에 에, 5월 9일날 새로운 정부가 들었을 때는 정말 바르게 정치할 사람을 저희들이 누군가 이 눈으로 똑똑히 보면서 판단을 하려고 노력을 하고 있고 그렇게 선거도 제대로 된 사람을 할 겁니다.
Of course, we will fight until the day that we die, until the day that Saad deployment is revoked. But because of this Park Geun-hye government's change, the impeachment and the detainment, that we are hoping that on the May 9th, when the new president is being elected, we will watch him or her very closely to make sure that they will reflect and speak on behalf of the people's will, not only for certain people's interest. So we believe that, you know, we can possibly change and overturn this decision.
Thank you. 두 번째, 그 여러분들이 저를 도와줄 수 있는 방법이 뭐냐고 물으셨는데요. 지금 이렇게 연대하는 것도 굉장히 도움이 됩니다만은 더 적극적으로 실제로 우리 한국에 찾아왔던 국방부 장관이라든가 이 정치에서 힘을 미칠 수 있는 그분들한테 이러한 평화운동을 우리 대한민국의 전 국민이 함께하고 있다는 그런 것들도 좀 전해주고 이런 것을 할 때 미디어 방송을 통해서나 SNS를 통해서 팩트, 사실이 좀 많이 전 세계에 알려졌으면 좋겠습니다.
So, you asked also what American citizens can do to help us. Well, doing this type of work, I mean the seminars to educate and disseminate is really helpful. But also more actively, if you can go and meet with your legislators or, you know, the government people or the minister of the defense ministry and tell them that, you know, the Korean people do not want that. Why are we pushing it, this agenda, onto this land? If you can do that, that would be great. Or also, we are believing now, we are learning the power of FNS. The true broadcasting, the true news versus fake news. If you can disseminate this information, our struggle stories all over the world through the SNS, if the main broadcasting companies are not going to cover us, then we have the social network to disseminate the truth. And then we can tell the people to help all of our struggle too.
미국이 큰 거대한 나라지만 우리 한국은 아주 조그맣습니다. 그런데 그 강대국이 이 조그만 약소국을 누르지 말고 우방으로 서로 친구로 이렇게 해서 함께 평화롭게 살아가는 그러한 세상이 오기를 저희는 염원하고 모든 사람들이 그렇게 기도하고 있습니다.
The U.S. is a really a big and wide and a huge country. And Korea is a really a small, tiny country. True allyship, true partnership comes from where you're mutually respecting one another, not, you know, one telling the other smaller country what to do. We believe that in the end, the peacefully, the people, the government, all the countries will learn how to coexist peacefully and respectfully and mutually beneficially.
Thank you.
3 more, we're standing right here. Okay, go right ahead, Joe. Yes, this is for Reverend Kim. Thank you first for coming in the name of peace and of the Buddha. And my question is that the Korean War ended with an armistice, not a peace treaty. And if we could sign a peace treaty with North Korea, would that help the situation come about? Thank you.
Great question.
We're doing this in a series. Yeah, I wanted to honor Reverend Kim for coming. I've been really concerned about the Jeju Island, and I live in the backwoods of Tennessee, but still my prayers are with you, and we see the same kind of military corporate attack on sacred lands and peoples, which happened right here in the United States at Standing Rock, and we will continue to resist. And I did have a question for her name. I'm sitting.
Ogata.
Ogata, yes. I was wondering if there had been any concerns with the situation in Fukushima with all this idea to go into militarism when the government hasn't really been able to do anything about that situation, which I think is very much of an influence on the entire world. And we've been monitoring the West Coast for evidence of that getting to our coast, and we're starting to see some small, very small signs of that radiation. And I was wondering if with all this talk of missile defense and things like that, that there was any consideration of what's happening in Fukushima. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm John Shushart, Veterans for Peace, House of Peace in Massachusetts. I have a question. In our newspaper, it's reported that there's an annual military exercise involving massive U.S. forces, aircraft carriers, jets, submarines, everything, in integration with the South Korean military involving all forces, rehearsing an invasion and attack upon North Korea. I believe these exercises just recently concluded in the last 2-3 weeks. They're massive, they're sustained, they are rehearsing a decapitating strike. How does North Korea know that this is not an attack, but is an exercise? And does this, in fact, risk a tremendous miscalculation, accident, or other precipitation into full-scale war, and obviously including nuclear weapons? If you could tell us a bit more about those exercises and what kind of risks and dangers are involved.
My name is Chuck Mine, Vets for Peace. My question is related to the countries of South Korea and Japan being sort of on the front lines in this area. And